Let's think about Google's world just for a moment. Google and everyone connected with the web knows that you lose 80% of your customers in 10 seconds. Why? 10 seconds is an eternity these days. I want you to just remember that just 10 seconds just for a moment, because it applies to your world too. We've been talking about live diagnosis. Who was it was talking about that just now? The importance of being able to get the live diagnostic result at the speed of light. Why? Because life is too short. 10 seconds is an eternity. Put your hands up if you find it really annoying when you get through to your electricity company and they say, press 1 for accounts, press 2 for customer service. Put your hands up if you find that unbelievably irritating. Put your hands up if you find it so irritating that you think a law should be passed in this state to make it illegal to install such a system so people can be put in prison who designed them, right? Okay, now, you have just shown me that you are passionate about 10 seconds. You're saying 10 seconds is eternity. 10 seconds is moral evil. 10 seconds is theft, right? And yet the strange thing is that the very people who know these things still put these systems in. So every IT company does it, every utility company does it, every large corporation does it, even though they know it screws up the customer relationship. Why? Because they forgot to think about life through the customer, through the beating heart of the customer, and they got so obsessed with the technological solution. I just say again, the future is not about medtech, it's about something else. Medtech plus something. Just going back to the Google world, we're living in a world now, of course, where the individual who's Googling knows far more than the physician about their treatment and about the medtech available. And again, if we're telling the story, we need to be selling direct. I know we've talked a lot about selling to surgeons and the rest, but we are dealing, I suggest, with a group of people who are much less well-informed often about the technologies that will be used than they are about the drugs they will be given, and that needs to change. And we're dealing with information overload, which I think is one of the greatest challenges for us in innovation right now. I did a project, and I work a lot with pharma companies. I did a project, back in 2003 on stem cell technology. I was given the opportunity to visit anywhere I wanted all over the world. I went to Harvard Medical School and so on. But you know what? I discovered that in the previous 12 months, over 2,300 wonderfully good research papers have been published on stem cell research alone. And that was then, in 2003. Even then, even those early days, when I was traveling around the world and I met a professor of using stem cells, let's say, in the reconstruction of the human eye, or in some other area, I discovered that most of them were entirely ignorant of each other's work. So I walk into there and say, if I shared something, I would only share things which were in the public domain and actually things which I knew this colleague was really proud of and really hoped that Professor John Pedersen would know about as well. And I say, well, actually, are you aware, John? I've just come from Martin's laboratory in Norway. He sends his warm greetings to you. Oh, yes, I know him well. Well, he's just published an extraordinary piece of work, which I'm sure he'd want you to know about. And you can hear a clunk, the jaw hit the ground. And I began to realize that if one of the greatest things we need to try to overcome is this institutional flurry, it's a coincidental danger, institutional blindness, but also institutional overload, the inability to put it all together. Look at this. This is Google's view of data in the world. The amount of data that is unconstructed versus structured. What's so fascinating about your research, sir, in terms of what I call a fingerprint of serum. And the genius of it, you don't even need to know what any of those compounds are. It's just mathematics. All you need to do is get that fingerprint, that barcode from that person's serum, and then compare it with the evolution of their medical history over the next 10 to 20 years, and you are sitting on a gold mine. Even better if we understand what some of those markers actually are, and we can relate them to physiological processes, but actually, who cares? You don't need to do that. All you need to do is be able to say, I can tell you, I've seen this serum before. I've seen only 15 cases, and they were all dead in 8 weeks. And I can tell you why they died. Over to you. This is what happens when we actually restructure data. And it is the biggest opportunity that medtech has ever produced. It's when we structure data and align it to some of the systems processes, procedures, and things that you're doing. And of course, mobile is transforming all of this, and so is the cloud, because the structuring of that data no longer needs to be in the local unit.